welcome to Mintel's Little Conversation podcast.
Welcome to Mintel's Little Conversation, where our experts bring you fresh ideas and new perspectives on how consumers eat, drink, shop, groom, and think. I'm Edward Bergen, global food and drink analyst, all-round foodie and hummus fanatic, which I'm going to say for the rest of time. This is the final podcast of our first series.
Boo.
It took you too long to say boo, guys. Before we start series two.
Yay!
Okay, we're great. It's a very special one, and our final topic of this year is a very seasonal one. Cue the sleighs, the elves and the reindeer, the holiday sales, the adverts and the overindulgence of food, entering our overdrafts due to spending too much on Lego, drinking too much, broken resolutions and a huge amount of chocolate consumption. I've given you a few clues. Welcome to our festive podcast. So we haven't just got one host. We haven't just got two hosts. We have five hosts. So rather than introducing them, these are the voices that you should have heard before. So we'll just start with Andrew.
Hi, Ed. Yep, I'm Andrew McDougall. I am the Associate Director of Global Beauty and Personal Care. So you normally would have heard me on the beauty pods, I imagine.
Brilliant. Sam.
Hello, my name is Sam Dover. I'm a Senior Research Analyst here at Mintel, writing on a whole variety of things, but including beauty, fashion and retail.
And Dana.
Hi, everybody. It's Dana Macke, Research Director over in the US office in Chicago. You'll recognize me by my American accent today.
Okay, and Andrew, yeah, realise that.
What an exciting introduction, Ed. I'm Andrew Davidson, SVP and Chief Insights Officer for Compare Media based in New York. And my area of expertise is credit cards and financial services marketing and America's podcast host.
Awesome. So are you excited for the festive period? Have you got some time off planned?
Yes, I've got about 2 weeks off, so I'm very excited about that. Although I'm also not excited because you have to buy presents and I've bought none.
I think I'm the exact opposite. I have 2 days off in addition to the holiday days, and I've pretty much bought all my presents, so I'm excited.
Maybe I could take tips from you, Sam.
You need to do a Freaky Friday switcheroo body swap movie so we can learn each other's ways.
That would be so depressing for Sam.
I'm looking forward to reboot Freaky Friday number 3. I'm sure it'll be out in the next few years. So it's a very simple format for today. We're going to just talk all things festive in our industry world. And to start with, we thought we'd chat about something that's expected before Christmas every single year or the holiday period, which is our advertising. And I know that we have a few adverts from Andrew that he wanted to share with us.
Yes, indeed. I thought, given where we're all based, obviously we're UK and the US, I think it's important to sort of start off by talking about the difference between the UK and the US when it comes to this festive advertising period. Because I think I'm safe in saying that in the UK, this is probably like the biggest advertising event of the year. And, you know, of course, historically, we've got all of these sort of emotionally stirring ads, you know, which started, you know, John Lewis probably kicked it off, right? 7 or 8 years ago. Mm. Whereas, you know, in the US, we have a little sporting event that you might have heard of called the Super Bowl, which is our biggest advertising event of the year. Now, that's not to say that, of course, Christmas and the holiday period in general is not, you know, huge, huge, huge in terms of advertising. It very much is. And we've seen some really fantastic executions recently. And a couple I wanted to talk about today, which I thought were really interesting. It stood out for me. Well, there's one from Xfinity. Xfinity is a cable and internet company in the US. And they have just launched a campaign called, which is sort of takes us back to E.T., which is, for those who remember, E.T. was a movie from the 80s. It came out in 1982. The lovable little alien came down to
Timeless.
Earth and visited. Have you all seen E.T.?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Classic.
Yeah, of
course.
Oh,
just checking. I saw it at the cinema, so that might age me. So E.T. came down to Earth. He met with a little boy called Elliot, and Xfinity have remade, like, basically it's a short story, and E.T. comes back to visit Elliot for the holidays, and of course he's visiting the now grown-up Elliot, the actor. And he spends a few days and they reconnect. And the whole theme is about reconnection. So I like that because it was all about going back to the 80s. And it's a nice theme, right? Nice theme. So that was one that resonated with me. Another really good one, which you might find interesting here in the US is Pepsi. Now, if you think about, you know, festive advertising, when you think about, soft drinks and drinks, you know, normally think about Coca-Cola and the polar bears, right? They've been focusing on polar bears for years. You know, actually they first started using the polar bear in 1922. So, you know, they've been focusing on polar bears for years, and now you've got Pepsi coming in, taking the, you know, trying to sort of go after Coke with the sort of whole Christmas theme. They're using Cardi B. They partnered with rapper Cardi B. And what's interesting is they've got this the campaign is called Gift It Forward with Pepsi. And so you take the can, and there's a QR code on the can, and then you scan the QR code with your phone, and you get entered into a chance to win between like $5,000 and $25,000, which you can then either give to a friend or give to charity. So it's sort of an interesting take on, gifting it forward, you know, going sort of moving into a space where, traditionally it's sort of associated with Coke. So it's sort of that whole battle, and it's sort of heating up. And it also shows a sort of the digital integration here, because, you know, even Coke now, apparently you with their cans, with the polar bears, they're building in augmented reality. So here you can scan the Coca-Cola can, and then the polar bears will come to life and have a snowball fight and do silly things. So I'm looking forward to buying one of those cans, even though I'm not a big Coke drinker.
Do they do anything with sustainability in the environment because of the polar bears? Have they gone into that space, like talking about saving the world and the fact that the polar bears are in trouble, David Attenborough style?
Yeah, I don't know, Ed. I don't know. But yeah, it would certainly make sense, right?
Some ideas.
Well, Pepsi
for them
also seems to be stepping on the share a Coke idea a little bit, about the idea of connection and sharing this, you know, beverage.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think they're definitely encroaching on Coke's territory.
A turf war, an all-out turf war. Yeah.
Right. I guess we were debating this before, you know, about the holidays versus Christmas. Of course, the holidays really start with Thanksgiving. And so a lot of these campaigns launched on Thanksgiving. You know, a lot of them launched literally, I think the Pepsi campaign was launched during the Macy's parade on Thanksgiving Day. You know, so that sort of kicks it off. And then these campaigns will run, you know, during the entire sort of holiday period. But I do like, you know, this, we've talked in our podcast about digital advertising, about the difficulty it is to get consumers, you know, to resonate. You know, you've got this age-old problem of resonating with ads, even though ads are better than ever. You know, you're still trying to get that relevance and resonate with consumers. So these are sort of interesting techniques to get consumers to engage with brands, using their phones, you know, participating and engaging, and you know, we'll see if that has a positive effect.
Amazing. Any other funky ads that we've seen?
Yeah, I saw an advert that was actually harks back to what you're talking about there, Andrew, in terms of, I think it was for Waterstones. I'm not sure though, maybe wrong, but it was, do you remember the Raymond Briggs, he did the snowman and then he did a Father Christmas cartoon. And there was a Raymond Briggs Father Christmas cartoon where he comes down the chimney, and it's kind of playing on that nostalgic feel, like you say, like harking back to these memories that you have of days gone by. But then when he gets down the chimney, he's confronted by like an Amazon Alexa and all these other sort of Internet of Things. And it's just quite, the comedy sort of plays out based on that. And it is, as you say, like that connection between that nostalgic feeling that makes us feel quite warm and fuzzy, but then catching up with, yeah, this modern world that we live in now. So I can't remember whose it was. I think it was a Waterstones advert, but I just thought it was a very heartwarming advert that I saw the other day that made that connection with me anyway, because I have fond memories of the Raymond Briggs cartoons.
Yes. I mean, and it, you know, obviously this festive time or this holiday period, there's a lot of focus on emotional connections and memories, and that, you know, advertisers are sort of tapping into that. And, you know, I guess the UK market is really where that's done to the extreme, right? You have this like deeply emotionally stirring ads that bring people to tears, you know, from the likes of John Lewis and Sainsbury's and the supermarkets. So, but, you know, you still get, you know, but it still get a different take here too in the US. Another one I really like, you know, obviously I always like to bring it back to financial services because that's my bag, but, you know, Capital One partnered with Walmart, and they've put out a very you know, actually specifically Christmas ad. You know, we're talking about holidays versus Christmas, which is all about, they call it holiday hints. And the ad sort of takes place where this family, you know, all trying to hint at each other what they want for Christmas. So, you know, the dad is wearing a sweater with a picture of a drill on it. And then the wife is like making a Christmas decoration of a grill. So it's sort of playing up this theme. But the, what's clever about it, of course, is the timing. You know, so he's got a credit card ad that's being launched at a time where obviously in this huge ramp up to the Christmas shopping season. Mm. And of course, what this card gives you is 5% back at purchases at walmart.com, not in the store, at walmart.com. and of course that's one of the big areas of, a you know, of growth, and that's where we're seeing a lot of spend going into the holiday season. So with that, it's the timing that's pretty clever.
Another one I want to bring up is Argos. So for our international listeners who don't know who Argos are, they're a British catalogue retailer launched about 50 years ago, I think. And basically this year, although they've been doing a lot of work over the last kind of few years about really digitalizing the business and making it far more digital, this year they've kind of done a big departure from their usual campaigns that really push kind of very specific products. And this year it's they've actually focused on the kind of the joy of the catalog. And it really, as we were kind of saying there, it kind of ties into this idea of bringing back a bit of nostalgia. And it really harks back to, and I can certainly remember as a child, going through the Argos catalogue, pouring my heart out over it in the lead up to Christmas and carefully picking each product, toy, whatever it may be that I wanted my parents to buy me. And I think it's so brilliant that they've kind of tapped into that and brought that idea back. And the advert shows this dad flicking through the Argos catalogue and he finds this drum kit which his daughter has kind of lovingly circled, and then it kind of brings in all this excitement about the dad then going and buying it for his daughter. And I just think it was a great example of, as you say, bringing back that emotiveness and that nostalgia that really is so important at Christmas. And like you say, it's so important in the UK market because it seems to be the ads that win that manage to do that.
This is a big year
nostalgia had a big play last year in the US around catalogs, because one of our big toy retailers went through bankruptcy, Toys R Us, and that was in the US. Everyone got the Toys R Us catalog and dog-eared the pages and circled the items when they were kids. And so last year, because Toys R Us didn't release a holiday catalog, Amazon and Target did really big gift catalogs to try and take the place of those. And so that was a kind of a big topic of conversation here last year, especially because one of the issues with the Amazon toy catalog is there's no prices, because Amazon is all dynamic pricing. So as a parent, when my child brings me the catalog with the things circled, I'm like, oh great, but I have no idea if that's like $500 or $5.
I'm glad you brought that up, Dana, because I was thinking, just as Sam was talking, I was thinking about the Amazon catalog, and it was like, because we did some good reporting on it as well at Confo Media, because it has they had stickers in the catalog, so you could rather than ringing the drum kit, you know, you could stick a sticker, or your child could stick a sticker on the exact toy they wanted, and then of course you have to use your phone to scan and find out that it's $500.
I had another funky ad I wanted to add before we move on to another one. We always get these big national adverts from the big retailers, and I saw this really lovely one that actually went viral. I think it was on YouTube and on Twitter and social media generally, from Wales, from a little hardware store called Hayford Hardware Store. And it's a whole advert about a little boy opening up his hardware shop and selling to the public and wrapping up the presents really badly and sweeping up at the end of the day, and then he leaves the shop. The little boy, you see him start to pick up a tree, and then really it's a grown man, and the caption is "Be a kid at Christmas," and it's just really lovely to show like that the fact that it's local, the fact that, you know, it's about having fun and being silly. I think it was just excellent to talk about sort of, especially our high street at the moment in the UK, which is getting a lot of focus about what's going to happen to our high street in the future with its decline. So I just thought it was lovely.
That's great.
Yeah, that's great. And from like the family perspective, I do most of the family research here in the US. I think that's something we see from consumers. One of the greatest joys of having kids is being able to see the world through their eyes and experience, especially holidays and traditions. Again, it brings all of that flooding back to you as you're like watching your children experience these traditions for the first time and being able to act like a kid with your kids. That's really smart. I like that ad.
It's absolutely right. So we're going to, now as we've moved into that section, we're going to get into anything new happening with consumers. Are they doing something different this Christmas? Is there any big stories? I don't know if Dana, you had, I remember we were talking earlier on about a few different things.
Yeah. So I don't know if you have this, I'm going to be asking a lot of questions of my UK counterparts today, because here in the US, most of our analysts, one of their predominant qualities is they find something in the market or something in the store or something in an ad that really bothers them or it jumps out to them and then they get very obsessed with it. And so my current obsession right now is holiday cards. Last year, The Atlantic published an article called Millennials Are Keeping Family Holiday Cards Alive. And it kind of sparked this idea in my head because I don't know if this happens to you, but I get stacks and stacks and stacks of holiday cards. And we've really seen a huge decline in postal mail just like over the last two decades. But it's interesting that these holiday cards keep coming and keep coming and keep coming. So of course, I'm seeing this in the market and I'm like, as a Mintel analyst, I'm like, we need to find out what's happening here. So we asked the question of our 3,000 consumer panel, do you send holiday cards via postal mail? I'm wanting to know, is it millennials that are keeping this holiday card tradition alive or is it not? Turns out, as kind of expected, older consumers are still much more likely to send holiday cards than millennial consumers. It's like 40% of millennials, which is a big number, almost half, are sending holiday cards. But what millennials are really sinking their teeth into are these personalized, these photo cards. Tell me, do you have this in the UK where you get 25, 50, 75 photo cards where it's just the photo and there's no, it's like the photo, the family photo, the name and no message on the back, because that's what I get stacks and stacks of.
But you can put the message on the back. Anyway, that's what we do.
Yeah, you can. But like the whole hypothesis of this article was that millennials love physical, tangible mail because they're in such a digital world. And I think it's actually the exact opposite, because what I'm seeing in the holiday cards is that there is no personal message. People aren't, the address is pre-programmed on there. It's digital. It's written in. It's not handwritten. They're stamped and sent by the company that did the, you know, the digital photo print for you. And so everything has been kind of digitized and automized. And what it really is it's like an Instagram post that you get in your mailbox. So it's kind of, instead
that's
of...
That's a really depressing commentary.
It is, though, right?
We've got a couple of brands that do it.
It's like bring it down. But I think millennials would love getting like the personal touch and a holiday greeting. And I think they've really kind of warped this into just another form of social media where you send this beautiful picture of your family to all of your friends with no message and not a lot of thought put into it. But the reason it kind of sparked again for me this year is we have this really interesting landscape right now because Shutterfly is really the major player here for digital photo cards, and they just got purchased by a private equity firm who also purchased Snapfish, one of their competitors. Shutterfly had just acquired a national school photo service. So like all of these digital photo services are being combined into this like huge super business. So I'm really interested to see what's going to happen next year, because I think they're building a business up, because I could see a Facebook, a Google, an Amazon, one of those major players that has delivery capabilities or photo capabilities or sharing capabilities really coming into this market and picking up this 40% of millennial consumers who are sending out these digital photo cards. So I want everyone to keep your eyes out for what's happening in your mailbox this year. I want you to count, are you getting a ton of these cards? Because there's definitely opportunity in this market for a major player to come out and maybe pull the rug from under Shutterfly's feet right now.
I don't know about everyone else, but like I've from a UK point of view, from my point of view, like we send, like I send and receive holiday cards, but they're not necessarily they're not like pictures of me. Like I know the kind of holiday card you're talking about, like the picture of the family and you send that out.
Yes.
That I can give you one of those outside of the holidays if you
want.
I want
a picture of you, Andrew.
We get the calendar though. We get the monthly Andrew of the month calendar, so that helps all year round.
Again, that's just going to depress you throughout the year. But thanks for saying that. But no, I think it is this idea that I think people do like sending the card, and it reminds me of my childhood, like the Christmas cards that used to come in the post from friends and family used to be like part of the decorations. They'd like get stuck up on the wall if there wasn't any space on the mantelpiece. Yep. And like, as I say, I do send and receive them now, although they're not quite as personalized as that in terms of the image. However, obviously you do write a message in them. In the UK as well, we tend to link a lot of Christmas cards with charities as well. So you buy like a stack of cards from the shop and they'll be giving to a certain charity. So you can feel like you're giving something to someone as well.
I guess the twist ending for me to my own personal anecdote here is that I do it. Like, I hate it, but I also do it. And all of you will be receiving a beautiful picture of my family for you can put on your mantle. Because I do it. There's no message. It's just a picture of my kids. And I'm like, here, happy holidays.
And is it Shutterfly in the UK?
Have a Moon Pig and Funky Pigeon. I think maybe some other brands as well out there that do the personalized sort of cards and birthday cards and stuff. I always send one to my mum and she still thinks it's an amazing novelty. How did you manage to do this? So that mum has been around for 10 years. So it's still exciting for her when she receives a personalized card with her face on like the Queen's body or something, which I've done a few times.
Yeah, well, that's because, I mean, in the UK, as you say, we definitely send holiday cards, but as you say, they're kind of traditional, bought out of a pack. You sit and handwrite them. But really, in terms of those kind of personalized cards with your own kind of pictures and stuff, they've really taken off in terms of birthday cards, thank you cards, invitations, all of that. But they've really not taken off in terms of Christmas cards. It just isn't really a thing to send a personalized Christmas card in that way here. So
it's coming to you. Yeah, it is coming to you. I'm telling you this now, especially, I mean, I think they just announced this week or last week that Facebook, this photo sharing deal with Google, where now there's a Facebook tool where you can export all of your Facebook photos onto a Google photo storage. So you're going to have all access to all of those selfies you've been taking for the last 10 years to send out to all of your friends and family for your holiday cards.
Okay, so we've talked about cards and I wanted to see what else is anything that's been spotted this year that we're buying, are people buying in store, any new industries that are coming out? I might get into food in a little bit, but is there anything you guys have seen in the, you know, what we're buying from shops?
I guess one thing I will flag up is just the insane amount of huge variety of advent calendars that you can get now. And I just think it's just something that you just can't ignore anymore. It's one of those things where you can get an advent calendar for pretty much anything now. And some of them, to me, I don't know about you guys, but some of them just seem a bit self-indulgent because I can't imagine them, many of them being bought as gifts. And I would imagine there's an element that a lot of them are just self-gifts. So the people buying gin calendars and beauty calendars and, you know, I think Ed, you mentioned it earlier about Lego calendars. You know, there's all sorts of, you know, calendars that are just taking it away from the kind of, I mean, very traditional calendars were, of course, just cardboard and you opened the pic to see what picture was behind the window, whereas now you get all sorts of products in there. And it seems like such a huge commercial opportunity. And we hear lots of, you know, brands and retailers saying that sales of these products are great every year. But like I say, it's just, to me, it's strikes as an odd concept in terms of, it seems like quite an indulgent gift to give in the weeks before Christmas actually arrives itself.
I think definitely this is on trend in the US with like parents being overindulgent with their kids. Like that's where I see it the most, is them buying these like advent calendars with socks or with goodies or with toys for their kids to like get every last bit of celebration out of that entire month that they possibly can. It's a lot though. And they're everywhere. They're absolutely everywhere.
They are?
Yeah.
I've always found it difficult to find them.
We need to go shopping, Andrew. You need to
you're not shopping in the right place, Andrew.
Go online.
I've always had to get them back in England.
So they're all available.
I guess I'm going to the wrong place.
It's interesting though, because I saw a figure just going back onto what Dana and Sam were both saying, actually. I think it was a US figure where like over a third of consumers actually buy a treat for themselves during sort of the Christmas period. Like, so it is this idea that I want to buy something for myself, and I'm glad Sam sort of brought up beauty advent calendars because it's kind of my thing. So because they play perfectly into this. Like in the UK, for example, the retailer Boots, they have a beauty advent calendar, and it's actually a huge waiting list for the number 7 range advent calendar because it's just so sought after, because it's such a great way to engage with consumers, like loyal consumers, but also encourage people to try new things. And there's just an absolute abundance, as Sam said, of all of these advent calendars, even within beauty. So like Selfridges have one, Liberty has one, like every single beauty retailer will have one, brands will have them. And actually, but one that I do kind of like the look of that I've seen this year is actually Kiehl's have teamed up with they have a Selfridges calendar that they made in collaboration with Janine Rule, and they've actually made a 12 days of Christmas beauty calendar. And what it is you get obviously 12 gifts for the 12 days, that 12 pouches filled with Kiehl's products. But there's very minimal outer packaging. So there's a real focus on sustainability. So the outer packaging itself is made from seeded paper. So you can actually replant it to soil, in soil, and you can actually grow your own flowers. And then once you're finished using the calendar as well, the idea is that you refill it for future holiday seasons, or you can use it as hanging storage in your home. And all of the products that are actually in the calendar as well can actually be taken into a Kiehl's store and be recycled as well through a TerraCycle scheme. So they've made sustainability a real focus of their advent calendars, because I think that's been maybe a negative thing about advent calendars, is it's encouraging
wasted cardboard.
Yeah, it's encouraging a throwaway culture. I think this Kiehl's option is just maybe educating people a bit more. I know L'Occitane have a sustainable option of their advent calendar as well, which gives people tips on how you can be more sustainable with your beauty purchases. So I think, without getting too serious around this festive time of year, I think it's important to have that message, given that this year and last year have been so focused on climate change and our impact on the planet. It's really interesting to see how the beauty advent calendar is playing in that space. Whether it's a gimmick or not, who knows, but at least it's putting the conversation out there.
I wonder if there's an opportunity there where, because I mean, as we were saying on earlier, it's this idea of like pass it on as well. And I can't help just listening to this. I can't help but think, is there an opportunity? Because you obviously get kind of X amount of products and there's very little control over which products they are usually. I wonder if there's like an element of brands and retailers should be promoting, you know, a bit of a pass it on vibe around beauty advent calendars and those kind of advent calendars where if you don't like that product, who do you know that...
There is this idea of having like maybe an advent calendar like swap shop or something like that, where you can actually turn up and swap with other people to be like, oh, I didn't like this day cream. I don't really use day cream, but I do kind of like a blush or an eyeshadow. So why don't we swap products? So yeah, I kind of like that idea as well. That kind of...
Nice.
Yeah. Or partnership between brands where a lot of different brands go in on an advent calendar together and there's like a variety of products there.
No, well, that's waiting to be launched. So Dana won't be at Mintel next year. We know what she'll be doing. Okay, we're getting to our towards the end. I wanted to talk about one industry that's close to my heart or my stomach, and that's the world of food. Not too many stories this year. It's just been all about, and you're going to hate me because I keep talking about it, but it's all about the vegan claim. This year is the first year where vegan Christmas has really taken off. It is pretty crazy. There's been two types which I've seen in store. You've either got very interesting party food that are just vegetables with interesting flavors, like the cauliflower, like Korean gochujang spicy cauliflower in little bites, or you're also getting things like the vegan Wellington. So pretend we beef Wellington. They've had, you know, tofurkey for years, but that expansion. Any of you planning to do the vegan Christmas or buying more from it this year?
Yeah, my mom and my sister are both vegan. So when I spend the holidays with them, they've been vegan for decades. It's very Amazing. Traditional for us to do like a veggie focused or a tofurkey or some kind of, you know, plant-based protein for holiday dinner. I don't know what it'll be, but I'll report back.
I have
what you find.
I have vegetarians in my family, so a little bit easier in terms of getting stuff for everyone to share that people will eat. But again, similar thing, it's been for decades, so it's always just been like a normal thing to have a vegetarian option in those kind of environment. So as I say, we still eat cheese, I guess. There's more variety with cheese. But
it's just become so much more established. Mm-hmm. So down to the Aldi from M&S or Waitrose in the UK, and I know in the States, I've seen stuff in Walmart and Target totally. Launching just loads of party food, little bites I think one of my other favorite ones was pulled barbecue jackfruit parcels. Yep. Within an Aldi range, just a little. So again, just playing on that space. This is the year for those options, without a doubt, for us to indulge. And then we get into Veganuary. So people going vegan in January. So why not start 6 days before then? and start over your Christmas table. We're going to come towards the end, but I wanted to ask each of you in turn to make a New Year's resolution. It can be a podcast resolution because of Series 2 will be back, but it can be just a personal resolution. The more entertaining, the better. Let's start. I'm going to go by my video screen that I have in front of me and start with Dana as our first resolution.
Yeah, so this is less a resolution and more of a challenge, and a call out to fellow Mintel podcaster Carol Wong Lee in Toronto office. Every year, I think for the past 2 or 3 years, we do a burpee challenge. So on January the 1st, we do one burpee, and on January the 2nd, we do two burpees, and then we go as far as we can. For listeners or hosts that don't know what a burpee is, it's like a push-up and a jumping jack together. It's the world's worst exercise. So Carol always beats me. She always outlasts me and does more burpees than I, but I would love to get more people in on this challenge this year. Maybe raise the stakes. We'll put a dollar amount on those, and whoever can outlast the others will win the pot. So this goes out to Carol. I know she's listening, that I'm ready January 1st to do those burpees.
And my burpees will come from probably overindulging. So that's how
we'll
I'll
take
be doing my
we'll
burpees.
We'll take it. You're in.
US-based Andrew, you're next.
Oh, going vegan in January. No, just kidding.
Nope, you said it.
Yeah, I like the way you want us to commit to a resolution in front of our, thousands, millions of listeners globally. Not that anyone's going to, I know all these people are going to hold us to this.
Now,
one thing, it's kind of not really a resolution, but on my bucket list, this is what I was thinking about, and I thought I'd say it. On my bucket list this year is for next year is to take my kids camping, or more like glamping, to the Grand Canyon, something I've really wanted to do since they were babies. Now they're teenagers. So I'm going to do that this year. That's on my list.
So,
nice. I don't know, eat more fiber.
The sexy resolution, Andrew.
Yeah.
Okay, on that note,
I feel like this is just health advice now, Andrew. It's just kind of it's just good ways to live your life.
do more podcasts.
Any. Sam, you're up.
So, do you know what? I have not come up with a New Year's resolution this year, although I will definitely come up with one at some point, because I usually tend to try and do something fun now. So I go completely against the whole idea that I'm going to suddenly turn myself into some health guru who does loads of exercise and eats perfectly and does all the right things. And basically, so I normally try and do something that's a bit more fun. So like last year I challenged myself to go to more gigs. So I went to an obscene amount of gigs and spent lots of money, but it was great. So I'm going to try and stick on that theme and try and find something fun.
Go to less gigs.
Yeah.
Okay. UK-based Andrew, you're up.
Well, I don't normally do resolutions because I just don't believe in them and they normally get broken. I'm a humbug for New Year's resolutions. However, for you, Ed, I've decided to come up with one, and I have decided I am going to draw more because I'm a bit of a cartoonist behind the scenes. So my New Year's resolution for you, Ed, is that I will draw more this year because
cartoon picture of me.
I will do a cartoon picture of you. I'll do a cartoon picture of all of the hosts. How about that?
I love it.
And we will do some
amazing artwork. Do we get to see the results?
I will do that. There you go. Like, I've thought of it just now. I will draw a picture of all of you and we'll just make some artwork for the podcast.
Amazing. On that theme, I'm not very closeted as a geek, but I am a very big comic book geek, and I have a very a sizable collection of comic books that I've been reading probably since the age of about 8. But they're currently just in boxes, either in my parents' house or in my house, in my cupboard, in all sorts of places. And my plan this year is to do the very sad thing and get an Excel document and put them all what have I got? What's all in that, in those lists, and then put them all away with all the tags so I know what I've got. So I'll be able to find the Spider-Man comic that I want and love.
I can't think of anything nerdier than an Excel spreadsheet full of comic books. Congratulations.
Yes. Yes. Comic books, food, my two passions.
Love it.
So that's the end of Series 1 and our festive podcast.
It's been a pleasure.
It's been a blast.
It has been a pleasure. So before we get into the final thank you, everything, thank you to to all of you, and a self pat on the back. So please make sure you pat yourselves on the back. It's been a great year. And we're going to be coming back for more in at sometime early next year. So for all you out there, please make sure you subscribe and rate and review and on any of the places that you get your podcasts. And if you want to check out Mintel, jump on our website, mintel.com, find us on social media, all that stuff. Otherwise, catch us, not next week, as we normally say, but catch us next year. And we look forward to you listening in again. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.